Our speaker is my very good friend and colleague, Dr. Wen Yeo, whom I've known for many years. He is the Director Emerita of the Stanford Geriatric Education Center, which she helped to found or originate in 1987. The Stanford Geriatric Education Center has been a significant force in developing the field of ethnogeriatrics, which is really increasing awareness of the impact of a number of factors that affect diverse communities, both their health and their mental health. Gwen officially retired from Stanford about 2 years ago in 2015, though like most of us, she never really retired. So she is still speaking and publishing and serving on the boards of local nonprofit agencies that serve older adults. So, without further ado, Gwen. Thank you. I was asked to share with you the result of a systematic review of literature on dementia prevalence and incidence in the ethnic and racial populations in the U.S., and it was published just this past January in the Journal of Alzheimer's and Dementia, which is the scientific journal of the Alzheimer's Association. So, the two ways that we can measure the rates of dementia in a population are prevalence and incidence, and since actually prevalence measures the burden of illness in a population at any one time, and incidence measures the new cases of dementia during a certain period of time, we decided to include both of those measures. We did a PubMed review, and we actually got 1,215 studies were identified, and then 14 others we found in other ways. So after we reviewed all those, we found 114 met our eligibility criteria for including in the review, which were having a representative sample of the population, using diagnostic measures that were approved, and being published in English. And when we began to analyze these studies, we found that it was going to be very difficult to compare because of the variations in the studies, and specifically, most difficulty was the variation in ages. And so as we know that age is the primary risk factor for dementia, and these studies varied from 40 plus to 100 plus in terms of the ages that they included. And we also found that some of the studies included nursing home populations, but did not. And we know that among many nursing homes, if not most, at least around half of the folks there have dementia. So that would make a big difference in the findings. We also found that they reported their data in lots of different ways. So we've done lots of reasons it's going to be difficult to compare. So what did we find given those limitations? Well, most of the literature is on African Americans. Most of the literature on dementia and ethnic and racial populations in the U.S. is on African Americans. And those articles, those 10 articles, were more than all the other populations put together. So they varied in the dates of their studies from 1985 to 2012. They varied in the age of the samples from 40 to 100. Their methods of recruitment were different, whether nursing homes were included or not. And the assessments that they used were different, and the procedures they used were different. So it was very difficult to find ways of comparing them fairly. They were also done in many geographic areas, different geographic areas. So the prevalence of dementia ranged, excuse me, from 1/100 of 1% in the 40 and over population in County, Mississippi, to 68% in the adults 100 years old and older in Georgia. If we compare studies that report the same age ranges, we find four that reported 65 and older, and they range from 7% in the East Baltimore study, what they call non-white populations, and to 22% in African American men in Dade County, Florida. If we look at those that reported results for age 85 and older, they range from 18% in the Indianapolis study to the 59% in the North Manhattan study. So you can see in both of these age ranges, the highest rates are 3 times higher than the rates for dementia in the lowest rate. So again, how do we make sense of those data? In 8 of the 10 studies of African Americans, a comparison group of non-Latino whites was also included. And 7 of those 8 studies, whites had a lower rate of dementia than the African Americans. When we look at the prevalence findings in the populations classified as Hispanic or Latino, we're struck by the differences among the subpopulations. In the largest Latino subpopulation, the Mexican Americans, the only prevalence and incidence study is the Sacramento Aging Latino Study. No, the Sacramento Area Latino Study of Aging, SALSA, of 1,778 Mexican Americans aged 60 and over that were recruited from the census tribe. In that study, 5% of those aged 60 and over and 31% of those 85 and over were found to have dementia. The only prevalence rate of study of Puerto Ricans, the second largest group of Latinos, included over 35,000 veterans aged 65 and over, and 13% were found to have dementia based on their ICD-9 codes in their health records. And the same prevalence was found in the Dade County, Florida study of Cuban American women aged 65 and over. The prevalence among men in that study wasn't reported because the data was considered unstable. Then an off-quoted study in North Manhattan included a sample of Caribbean Hispanics, the majority of whom were from the Dominican Republic, with smaller numbers from Puerto Rico and Cuban elders, but it had no Mexican Americans in that study. Their results were only reported by age category, which ranged from 8% in the 65 to 74 age range, and 28 up to 63% in the over 85 age range. So we can see that if we compare the North Manhattan findings at 85 plus to the SALSA findings of Mexican Americans, we see that it was twice the range in the Caribbean Hispanics as it was in the Mexican Americans. Two of the Latino studies had comparison groups in non-Latino white. In the Florida study, the white women had slightly lower rates of dementia than the Cuban women. In the North Manhattan study, the white sample had about half the rates of the Caribbean Hispanics. I'm having trouble with this clicker. Okay. If we look at Asian Americans, unfortunately, the only prevalence data that's available are among Japanese Americans. And one of the two studies is among the survivors of over 8,000 men in the Honolulu Heart Study that were recruited in the 1960s. In the 1990s, over 3,700 survivors participated in the study of dementia. 8% of those over 65 and 33% over 85 were diagnosed with dementia. Then in the common study, the Japanese American men and women from the Seattle, Washington area, 6% of those over 65 were found to have dementia. The preliminary data were published from a study of over 600 Korean American elders recruited from Korean churches in the Baltimore and Washington, D.C. area. Their screening data indicated that 7% scored in the range of suggested dementia. So it's an ongoing study. We'll look forward to more complete data there. It's very sad, I think, that we have no data on dementia rates among the Asian American populations that are larger and still. So we don't know if the largest one, the Chinese Americans, or other large groups such as Filipino American, Asian Indian, Vietnamese American, are they in the same range as the Japanese Americans? We just don't know. We don't know about the smaller groups either. American Indians also are missing in terms of the data that's available. There are no reliable studies. And most Pacific Islander populations are also missing. I did want to mention the unique history of dementia among the Chamorros, the indigenous population of Guam. In the 1950s, high rates of a unique Parkinson dementia complex and an ALS were recognized among the Chamorros. Then in the last 50 years, that disease has decreased significantly, but another unique late onset dementia has occurred, and it's called Guam dementia, and is characterized by neurofibrillary tangles, the tau that we've heard about this morning, but without the amyloid plaques. So it's considered a very unique variant. In 2003, an island-wide survey of Chamorros aged 65 and older found that 9% had the Guam dementia, and 3% had dementia from other causes. So that's what we know about prevalence. Turning to incidence, I hope you can make sense of this chart. It may be difficult to read, but there is a copy in your handout if you're interested. So there are approximately the same population that we found in the prevalence studies. And there's still some differences in methodology. But my co-author, Paula Mason, was able to reduce the data from to annual incidence. So she was able to compare some of them. But you can see there are variations among the incidence both within and between the ethnic and racial populations. You can see especially the variations in the African Americans that are shown in yellow. Then she looked at the average for each population category and found that the highest rates were among the Caribbean Hispanics in the North Manhattan study, the majority of whom were Dominican, followed by African Americans. And the lowest rates were in the Salsa study of Mexican Americans, and mid-range values found among the non-whites and the Japanese Americans. I'm going to skip this slide because of time constraints, but basically it was from the North Manhattan study, and they found that if they controlled for the differences in education and age between the three populations, that the large differences among them disappeared. And other studies have also found that education is a major risk factor, especially in minorities. So what did we learn from the reviews? Well, first, there's a major gap in the evidence for rates of prevalence or incidence in dementia in the different ethnic populations. So we don't have data for some of the major groups, population groups. Second, it's impossible to compare the results fairly within or across the population groups because of differences in age and recruitment and strategies,
diagnostic methods, and how results are reported. So as a result, we cannot accurately document the disparities. And third, it's important to disaggregate the data on ethnic subpopulations within the large ethnic and racial categories used by the Census Bureau. For example, among populations classified as Hispanic-Latino, the lowest and the highest prevalence and incidence rates for any studies were found. So if we lumped them all together and called them Hispanic and tried to get a rate, it would be very misleading. And that is done by many, many reports and organizations, including the Alzheimer's Association reports that way. So how we can, So if we wanted to improve them, we could, there are three things we could do. We need a standardized protocol that all the researchers could use and use the same age ranges and study and criteria assessments and so forth. And that we need to fill in the gaps, get the missing data on the different ethnic populations that are not represented in the data. And we need to have some of those folks participate in research. We, if we wanted to talk about clinical practice, we need to think about the language issues that are important in doing the assessment. That is, every language group who are with low English literacy needs to have their own type of assessment that's valid. And we need appropriate measures for the low literacy and for people who don't have any education, and that's common in some populations. We need to control the comorbid risk factors, such as diabetes in Mexican Americans and the stroke and hypertension. And of course, we need to pay attention to the health of family caregivers, because we know that in many cultures, they're mandated for family care. So I'll stop there, and we can talk more about it in a question and answer session. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Yeo. I think that I'm glad you added some clinical implications there at the end, because I know that many people in the audience are very interested in that and need to be thinking. We need to be thinking about the implications of those findings and the difference in prevalence.